Sir, can we set a time limit? Because most of these cases would be presented at short cases during an examination.
Yes, sir. You want to, how do you want to happen, sir?
Can we set 15 minutes for the history
Presentation
and
part of
presentation?
it, sir. Okay,
Yeah,
sir.
15
Let
minutes
him
for
go
the
run
history.
through the full presentation, then we can have
Okay.
the talk. Yes,
All
sir.
right. We'll ask him to present it completely, sir. Then you can question.
You should start up.
Yes,
Either
sir.
you present fully.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure,
Yeah.
sir. A 44-year gentleman, bike mechanic by occupation, residing at Tirupur, belonging to lower socioeconomic class, came to our hospital with chief complaints of swelling in the front of neck for the past 2 years. History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently well before 2 years. Then he noticed a swelling in front of neck, which was insidious in onset. It was small in size, then gradually progressed to attain the present size. The swelling was not associated with pain. There is no history of pressure symptoms like difficulty in swallowing, difficulty in breathing, or any syncope. There is no history suggestive of hyper or hypothyroidism. There is no history of trauma. There is no history of fever. There is no history of loss of weight or loss of appetite. Coming to past history, there is no history of previous surgeries or radix exposure in the past. There is no history of close contact with tuberculosis, comorbid condition. That is, he's not a known case of diabetic hypertension or coronary artery disease, chronic kidney disease, or thyroid disorder. To coming to treatment history, there is no history of any previous treatment for this complaint. Personal history, appetite normal, takes non-vegetarian by diet, bowel and bladder habits found to be normal, is a chronic alcoholic and smoker for the past 20 years, smoked 10 pack years. Family history, there is no history of similar complaints in the family. Case summary, a 44-year male, chronic smoker and alcoholic with no comorbidities, presented with chief complaints of swelling in the front of neck for the past 2 years, which was insidious onset, progressive in nature, with no hypothyroid symptoms, with no pressure effects or no malignant symptoms.
You proceed with this, you proceed with the final, your examination.
Okay, sir. Coming to general examination, patient is comfortable at rest, well built and moderately nourished.
Go to the inspection bar. It's a short case absent present.
Okay, sir. Examination of neck with informed consent with an adequate exposure in sitting position. Patient was examined in a well-lit room. On inspection, a single swelling of size 4 into 3 cm present in the right side of anterospect of neck, which is semispherical in shape, extends from 1 cm below the symphysis mentae, 4 cm above the suprasternal notch, 1 cm lateral to midline, 1 cm medial to anterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Surface found to be smooth with well-defined margin. Skin or the swelling is normal. The swelling moves with debilitation. Swelling moves with protection of tongue. The swelling is deep to deep fascia as well as muscle. There is no visible pulsations. There is no scar, sinuses or dilated veins. This is the swelling. On palpation, there is no warmth or tenderness. A single swelling of size 4 into 3 cm present the right side of anterospect of neck, which is semispherical in shape, extends from 1 cm below symphysis mentae, 4 cm above the suprasternal notch, 1 cm lateral to midline, 1 cm medial to anterior border of sternocleidomastoid, with surface smooth, well-defined margin. Skin over the swelling is normal, which is cystic in consistency, moves with debilitation, moves with protection of tongue, fluctuation positive, transformation negative. The swelling is deep to deep fascia as well as muscle. And trachea is in middle normal position, carotid pulsation filled. This is a video showing swelling moves with debilitation. On other system examination, CVS, S1, S2 plus, no murmur, respiratory system, bilateral RNT plus, there is no added sound. Per abdomen, soft bowel sounds plus, no warmth or tenderness. Examination of.
Don't you diagnose?
Yes,
sir.
Case summary, a 44-year male, chronic smoker and alcoholic with no comorbidities, present with complaints of painless swelling in front of neck for the past 2 years. On examination, 4 into 3 cross soft cystic fluctuation swelling present in the right side of anterospect of neck, which moves with debilitation and protrusion of tongue. My diagnosis will be a case of thyroglossal cyst.
Dr. Kishore, it yes, never sir. Looks like it is a midline swelling, lateral swelling. You always have to mention where the swelling is, lateral, midline. There are more important things that will give you more idea on your inspection of whole finding. We are not reaching anywhere.
Yes, sir. So midline swelling, sir.
No provisional diagnosis can be made.
Okay.
Please elaborate which quadrant it is, where it is situated.
It's present in the upper part of the anterospective neck, sir.
It's
a midline swelling, but it has been mildly shifted towards right, sir.
Who do you want to make it as a midline swelling?
So I don't see.
You are trying to make it as it's a midline swelling, it's shifted. What is that mechanism? What made you think like that, present like that? It is a midline swelling shifted to the left side. How do you come to that conclusion? Looking at that picture, what you are showing, doesn't appear that it is a midline swelling.
I don't think so, sir. It is lateral swelling. It is touching over the sternocleidomastoid. It is not a midline swelling. Midline is defined right in front of thyroid. It is looking like a lateral swelling from AP view.
So you should keep that your options open. What okay. Sirs wants to say that do not stick, because it is a moving with deglutition and moving protrusion of tongue means the swelling has to be midline. Remember, thyroglossal cyst need not to be in a midline. That is Jailal sir wants to say. Understand this point. So don't stick that because it is thyroglossal cyst, it has to be a midline. Usually thyroglossal cyst will be on one side, not in a true midline. That's what the sir wants to do. Thank you, sir.
Kishore, sir. For the sake of know the diagnosis, don't manipulate your clinical findings. Mm-hmm. If as I am seeing from here, I would have told this as a swelling in the anterior triangle, upper neck. So classical, and it is not accepted if you say it is from suprasternal space 4 centimeter above. See, it is like Kanyakumari to Kashmir, you are telling. So I would have been happy. I can see his thyroid notch there, prominent thyroid cartilage.
It is above it.
You would have told roughly vertically extending from whatever that somebody told, no? Sternomastoid, then come down up to the thyroid cartilage. Okay. Horizontally, of course, you might have felt better. Maybe it would have gone to the midline. But as we are seeing from here, you should say, if you say it's front of the neck, it is not accepted.
Yes, sir.
Should not do that mistake.
Exactly. The point, it is for all PGs.
Yes.
Remember that describe what you see. Do not describe the diagnosis. That is a common mistake all the PGs make, because they have a diagnosis in their mind. That is a wrong thing. Describe what you see and then read the diagnosis. Similarly, you have described cervical lymph node in systemic examination. Why?
Sorry, sir.
No, this is a part of neck examination. Okay. Because you were preoccupied that this is thyroglossal cyst, there will not be a lymph node. Do you understand? The lymph node in a cervical region is a part of your neck swelling examination.
Okay.
Understand this point very clearly.
You must be also careful. You are repeatedly saying it is a 4 into 3 centimeter, but hemispherical swelling.
Okay, sir.
Spherical swelling will have only one diameter. You cannot have a 4 into 3 into a hemispherical.
Can you, Dr. Kishore, can you show the movement with deglutition and protrusion of tongue? You had a video, I think. Can you play that?
It's not working.
Not able to see him.
It's difficult anyway.
Video was not working, sir.
Okay, no issue.
We can't see that.
It's all right, no issue. Okay. So what are the points which suggest that this is thyroglossal cyst? Or would you like to put a differential diagnosis?
Yes, sir. Diagnosis of thyroglossal cyst as a patient, swelling is present in the anti-triangle of neck with soft and cystic in consistency with fluctuation positive, which moves with deglutation as a protrusion of tongue and more point towards thyroglossal cyst.
Sir, wait. Sir, now only said answer to my question. He asked, would you like to give a differential diagnosis?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that is what is the answer to the question, the previous cases. So you answered to sir's question. If it's a cystic swelling in the neck, how do you classify the cystic swelling? Or in this place, what are the other cystic swelling you think of?
Yes.
Answer that question.
Might be a case of a branchial cyst or a sublingual dermoid can occur here.
Just a minute. We'll discuss one by one. Branchial cyst, what is normal position?
Upper one third of sternocleidomastoid. Is that present in the carotid triangle, present in the upper one third of sternocleidomastoid.
So the branchial cyst is described, it is partially behind the sternocleidomastoid, anterior border is felt, and it is around at the junction of upper one third and lower two third of sternocleidomastoid. So it doesn't fit in that, right?
Which age group is common?
Yes, that's another question.
Second to third decade is common, sir.
Okay. Okay. Good. Other, now next.
Might be a case of a sublingual dermoid can occur.
Yes, why not? Very good.
Only thing is sublingual dermoid also can move with deglutation, with the transmission negative, with a soft and cystic swelling.
The thyroblast is always translucent positive?
No, sir. May or may not be, sir. Based upon the content, it might be or may not be a transmission.
Dr. Kishore, what is the shape of classical shape of thyroglossal cyst and what is the shape of subhyoid bursitis?
Yeah, very good question.
Yes.
Subhyoid bursitis will be a somewhat oval shaped swelling, sir.
Vertically oval?
Thyroglossal cyst is also oval swelling.
Vertically oval in thyroglossal cyst, whereas it is transversely oval subhyoid bursitis.
Location? Yes. Location?
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 Location is between the hyoid bone and in front of thyroid membrane.
So, keeping all these things in mind, what are the odds? Odds means somehow it is not fitting in with thyroglossal cyst. What are the odds in your case? You tell me, if at all.
Swelling is somewhat lateral to midline, sir.
So, can you explain this?
Sir, might be the swelling which is present in that area. In case of swelling in front of thyroid cartilage, the swelling usually moves to one side, sir. So, in my case, it might be the swelling might be moved to the other side.
So, whenever an anomaly you are suspecting, this is a thyroglossal duct tract cyst. There can also be an ectopic positions. Please remember this. It can always happen in the neck because this is a thyroglossal cyst. Is as rightly put it, it is never in the midline, number one. Number two, slight deviation is always, it is possible. So you need to keep it in mind, but you need to know the 3-4 differential diagnosis in this.
That is the one more differential diagnosis, one or two. Would you like to say?
Might be a plunging ranula can.
So you have examined oral cavity?
Yes, sir. Oral cavity found to be normal, sir.
Okay.
There is no features of ectopic thyroid.
Lingual thyroid. Why it is not ranula from your finding? Single one thing.
Transient, sir.
Yes. So. Excellent. If it is a ranula, it is brilliantly transilluminant. The word which is used in. What is plunging ranula?
Ranula which is present in the floor of the mat, which will penetrate the mylohyoid muscle, which will come out around the present in the neck region. So there will be a dumbbell shaped swelling. Swelling may present inside the oral cavity as well as in the neck region.
I have.
You can confirm this diagnosis by a bidigital palpation.
Wait. I have one important thing to mention, Kishore. Thyroglossal cyst will have three types of mobility you need to know. Number one, moves with the deglutition. Number two, moves on protrusion of the tongue is better. You hold the swelling. It is actually called as a tug, you know, this kind of a tug. So, when you demonstrate that, if the examiner asks you to demonstrate movement on protrusion of the tongue, it's better to hold it, not only inspection, that is one. Lastly, intrinsic mobility. Intrinsic. This, I think, I don't know, you have not mentioned in your presentation about the intrinsic mobility.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Any other differential diagnosis?
Any other brilliantly transluminant swelling in that area?
Or non, according to him, non-transluminant. Let me ask you one question. We have not reached the investigation part, but okay. Let me. Can it be ectopic thyroid?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What are the reason why it is ectopic thyroid? If yes, or what are the points against?
Protrusion of tongue.
One, okay. But still it is debatable anyway. Doesn't matter. What else?
Location, sir.
Location, this can happen.
Fit into that.
Okay.
Can it be ectopic? So when will be the ectopic thyroid usually becomes visible? At what age?
No, no, sir.
So remember, there are two types of ectopic thyroid. You should keep it in mind. One is when the normal thyroid is absent. And second is there can be presence of thyroid along the course of thyroglossal duct. It can be there. Usually, though it is said that it is a congenital condition, it is usually not present at the time of birth. But when you have put a diagnosis or an investigation that it is a soft cystic, it is unlikely to be ectopic. And second is the patient is 44 years of age, which goes against. But if it is younger patient, you are putting a diagnosis of thyroglossal cyst, always keep ectopic thyroid in your mind.
Okay.
Right? Because that will be useful when you go to investigation and ruling it out.
Yes, sir.
That should be kept in mind. Last but not least, which can be brilliantly transilluminated, as your sir has said, Srinivasan sir has said. Which other differential diagnosis?
Cystic hygroma.
Yes, yes. Very good.
Very good.
Yes. So age is not that, but yes, I cannot deny it. Okay. Any other differential diagnosis?
Cold abscess.
No. You are doing well. Don't go in cold abscess. Another is, but yes, cold abscess is always a possibility. One is a cyst of submandibular salivary gland.
Okay.
Which this area, that's why I was insisting that you should describe the area exactly. But again, movement with deglutation and movement with protrusion will not be there. But cystic swelling in this area, you should always consider all of them. Please continue.
Nina, Madam Montera.
Same question. I was asking about cystic hygroma. He answered it.
Kishore, what is the usual site of the thyroglossal cyst? Is it more on the right side or left side?
The left side, sir.
And your swelling is on the right side, isn't
it? Yes, sir. In my patient, the swelling is on the right side.
And out of the various locations of the thyroglossal cyst, which is the commonest location? What are the various locations?
Subhyoid, sir.
Yeah. What are the other locations?
Foramen cecum, beneath the foramen cecum, floor of the mouth, suprahyoid, subhyoid, in front of thyroid cartilage.
Because in this patient, you examine the oral cavity after you finish the systemic examination. The oral cavity is probably, it was the most important examination this patient. So apart from looking at the, only for that, what else you will look in the oral cavity?
Yeah, lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid.
Yeah, you can get the lingual thyroid there. Okay. So that is a very important oral cavity examination which you have carried out to rule out the ranula in this patient. Now, why did you not keep a possible the lipoma here? That is the most common swelling, which will give you all the findings like that. It will give you the pseudo fluctuation. It will give you the pseudo transformation. Everything it will give you. So why not a simple lipoma?
Yes, sir.
That should also be kept in mind. You know, right?
Lipoma goes with the deglutation.
No, sir.
Okay.
So which other swellings move with
the deglutation? Which lipoma will move with the deglutation? Jo hai?
No. Which other swellings?
Tell what are the various swellings which move with the deglutation? Jo hai?
Thyroid can move deglutation. Thyroglossal cyst, subhyoid bursitis can move with deglutation. Pre-tracheal and pre-laryngeal nodes can move with deglutation. Sir.
No, with protrusion of the tongue.
Protrusion of tongue, thyroglossal cyst.
What else? You know, fat tissue is present everywhere.
Okay, sir.
Right? So,
you can have a fatty tissue around that, and you have the lipoma which comes in front of the thyroid cartilage. You get that. Okay. So really, you can find all those things, you know. It may be attached to the trachea, right? A lipoma which is adhered to the trachea. So you can get these findings even in the case of a lipoma also, right?
Okay, why the thyroglossal cyst moves with protrusion of tongue?
Because the thyroglossal duct tract failure to regress, it has communication with the foramen cecum. So on protruding the tongue, the foramen cecum pulls the thyroglossal tract upwards, so the swelling also moves upwards.
So is it a duct or tract which is important?
Tract.
Okay. So why the thyroglossal cyst forms?
Failure of regression of thyroglossal duct tract as a part will lead to a cystic swelling in the neck, sir.
It is lined by what?
Pseudocytomy ciliated columnar epithelium, sir.
So in which category of swelling it falls?
Retentions.
Tubulodermoid
type of.
It's a tubulodermoid. What is that? What is tubulodermoid?
Tubulo embryonic dermoid.
Yes. Any other place you know where there is a tubulo embryonic dermoid is there?
Bottom.
One is top and one is bottom.
Macro.
Very easy.
Macro.
Sure.
Midline.
Bottom, you are given hint. You should speak.
It's in the midline.
Back.
Not on.
You will do a DRE for that.
Sir?
Giving you a clue, you'll do a DRE. For the digital rectal examination. Doesn't know, sir.
No, sir.
Post-anal dermoid, okay.
Post-anal,
okay. Sure. Sure. This,
what other tumor dermoid?
Yeah.
Sir? What just, others you know? One, you said the thyroglossal cyst. Second is the post-anal dermoid. Any other tubulodermoids you know?
Don't
know, sir. It may be urethral cyst. Okay, or it may be ependymal cyst.
Okay, sir.
These are the other tubulodermoid
cysts
which are there. Right?
Okay, so if there is a sublingual dermoid, is it same thing? What is difference when you find dermoid and this tubulodermoid? What is difference?
This sublingual dermoid is due to sequestration of all the midline. All the layers of the mesoderm, as well as ectoderm, endoderm. Whereas,
sorry, wrong. What is sequestration dermoid?
Fusion of all the.
What is the meaning of the word sequestration?
Epithelial fusion.
Sir, told the answer. Please pick up.
Sequestration literally means abduction. So the original area, it is abducted to another area, then it is developing into that.
So it is not all three. If all three layers are involved, what do you call it?
Teratoma.
So that is, dermoid is a sequestration of the ectoderm in mesoderm.
Okay.
You should, it is a predominantly ectodermal tissue which goes inside, and usually it is at find at the site of fusion. So at the time of fusion, some ectoderm goes inside.
Okay.
So is it a congenital condition or no?
Yes, sir. Congenital condition.
Okay. So if you see a sequestration dermoid, any teratoma, what will be the difference in content?
Yeah. In teratoma, there will be content of muscular elements, skeletal elements. It involves both mesoderm, inguinoderm, as well as
contents. Very good. So commonly we see the teeth, cartilage, whatever it is. And what will you see in sequestration dermoid predominantly?
Hair follicles alone.
Hairs, not follicle. Follicle you cannot see. Hair and discamated ectoderm. So that is the basic difference between dermoid and that. So what will you see in a thyroglossal cyst? It is a dermoid. It is a tubulodermoid.
Only mucin contains present.
Mucin?
Secretions around present. Epithelial debris.
So what is the lining of that tubulodermoid? How is it lined?
Pleurostratificated.
Yes. Right? So from where does the fluid come?
From the columnar epithelium.
Right. And what will be the content of fluid?
Mucin, sir.
Mucin. So it is a lining. It's a different. Remember, sequestrum dermoid is an ectoderm, where here it is actually an endoderm. That's why it is known as a tubulodermoid. So secretion, you will not see the hair or anything. Predominantly, it is a gelatinous liquid material containing rich cholesterol.
Okay.
Right? The sir has asked one question, that left side thyroglossal cyst is common. Why? I think you answered or not, I'm not very sure. Khanna sir, did he answer that?
No,
but he answered about the location of that.
Location is right. But why the left side it is more common? Their answer is same practically. That is the thing. Sir has given you it. Because of the direction of thyroglossal duct, it is a deviation on the left side is very common. Right?
Dr. Kishore, thyroglossal cyst is a remnant of thyroglossal duct. What are the other remnants?
Sir?
Sinus. Thyroglossal cyst is a remnant of thyroglossal duct. What are the other remnants?
So, indirectly, sir is asking you what can happen at the thyroid level, what can happen at the tongue level, tongue.
Fistula formation.
Can you modify, think, what is a lingual thyroid?
Failure of a thyroglossal duct to descend downwards.
What is pyramidal lobe?
Pyramidal lobe is a lobe that is present extending from fibrous standard is extending from the isthmus to that of
again it is on the left side or right side?
Left side, sir. Left side. Yes.
Srihari, sir, what are the answers expected, sir?
Same thing. Yeah. The pyramidal lobe,
thyroglossal
cyst, and the levator glandular thyroiditis.
Correct.
And sublingual. Exactly. Thyroid.
What is function of thyroglossal duct?
It descends out to from thyroid follicles, sir.
Yes. So that's an ectopic thyroid is also. That is the you should keep in mind. Right? So how the thyroid is formed? Sometimes some examiner may ask you this question.
During third week of gestation.
No, not for again. Predominantly, it is only from thyroglossal duct or something else is there.
As well as from the ultimobrachial, fourth pharyngeal arch. From ultimobrachial body, these two effusors will form the thyroid glands.
So usually, thyroid tissue comes from thyroglossal duct. But parathyroid is formed by the branchial clefts. So it is a combination of this. And ultimobrachial form the stroma rather than the glandular tissue comes from thyroglossal duct. That should be kept in
mind. What is the fate of the thyroglossal cyst? Why sir, you want to operate?
It may get infected, sir.
And it may get infected. What else?
Fistula can occur, sir.
What else it can happen?
Malignancy can occur, sir.
All malignancies you will get?
No, sir. Medullary you won't get, sir.
Why?
Because the thyroglossal tract will lead to the thyroid follicular cells, whereas the medullary won't occur because it leads to another pathways. Like ultimobrachial body will lead to formation of parafollicular cells. So it is some other pathway. So medullary CA is more yes, it won't occur in a thyroglossal tract.
Okay. What is the commonest malignancy possible in thyroglossals?
Papillary CA, sir.
Papillary. Okay, go ahead, please.
What is the content? As you say, one is a mucus. What other cholesterol? So where else you will find out cholesterol?
Branchial cyst. Branchial cyst, dentigerous cyst, na hydrocele can contain cholesterol crystals.
Okay.
Okay. So now what will you do in this case?
Sir,
to confirm your diagnosis.
I would like to confirm my diagnosis by doing investigations like thyroid profile to see the patient is urethral state, ultrasound of leg to find out the presence of any ectopic thyroid or the normal location of thyroid, as well as MRI of neck to the extent of the swelling, FNA of the swelling.
Sorry, just why MRI is mandatory in this case?
Dr. Kishore, writing in a theory paper is different from the clinics, number one. Okay. In the clinics, no, in the exam, we can't afford to use MRI for in a government college or even for that matter, private for such a costly investigation. Okay. And also, unless there are specific, you need to tell if you have a doubt whether it is a diagnostic difficulty, maybe there. Looking at the position, whether it is a vascular spaces or whether it's a ramifications. Yeah, I'm not talking about thyroglossal cyst in general, I'm talking about. So only that is the time. I think you can straight away tell ultrasound and then proceed, I suppose.
Okay, sir.
The point is that there are rare indication of doing MRI in this case. On one side, you are very clear that patient swelling moves with deglutation, swelling moves with protrusion of tongue. So it hardly leaves any doubt about it.
Okay,
ultrasonography is a basic investigation and we all examiner believe that is the extension of your clinical examination. So yes, but MRI you should not use lightly as far as this particular swelling is concerned. Okay. Sir is wanting to say that. Specific indication, if it is there, very rarely you will get a very large thyroglossal cyst. We have seen quite a few cases when it is very difficult to elicit the taste, whether it moves with deglutation or not, right? So there you have done ultrasonography and it shows there is no thyroid tissue at the normal site. What will you do?
Okay. One question. Suppose the same swelling appears in a 4-year-old child, what would be our first investigation of choice? Both SARS question and my question are the same.
Sure. No. Sir, Modi sir asked one question. Rao sir is asking if the same swelling occurred in a 4-year-old child. Okay. What will you think?
First investigation.
Thyroid function test.
No, Modi sir asked that you don't have a thyroid in ultrasound, not in this case.
Okay.
Sir is asking in a 4-year-old, you have the same swelling.
What is the common cause in children?
Cretinism, hypothyroidism, goiter.
That's a condition.
This is the problem. The point here is that sir has asked very specific. What is the common swelling at the 4-year of age? In this situation. And my question is thyroid is absent at the normal site. Actually, they are interconnected. You have already said this. What will you think?
Absence of normal.
This is what the
exam is all about. You know it, but you cannot say it. Yes, we have already discussed 2-3 times. Same thing. Do you understand?
Think about that it should not be. Because you have said 2-3 times, he thinks that it should not be ectopic.
The extension of question is that if you find such a situation, what will you do?
It's your normal thyroid is absent. This is the only the functioning thyroid tissue. What are you going to do, sir, is asking.
Will you do management or surgery?
Surgery, sir. Postoperatively, I will give
Usually lingual thyroid and all respond very well. Yeah, exogenous supply with the conservative line of management is the first line of management.
So there are 2-3 ways. You said something about FNAC. The best investigation is
ultrasonography.
Ultrasonography is done, but still you have to be very sure that this is the functioning thyroid. When the function of thyroid comes, the answer is one. That is,
where else is the thyroid is there? How do you diagnose?
Radiodin scan. Can.
Yes, yes, that is what. Scan. That was the actually isotope scan was the answer from begin. Right? You want to establish that patient hasn't got this only functioning thyroid tissue. If it is the only functioning thyroid tissue, what will you do? Then there is a further answer. What will you do if you have done a scan and it is the only functioning thyroid tissue?
I will operate and then post-operatively I will give a...
Like sir has already said, you are not... Jailal sir has said something.
Don't operate. Yes.
Conservative management.
Yes. What conservative management?
Yeah.
What is the cause of this enlargement? Think again.
Normal cause. Sir. The biter, what is the physiological cause?
Sir, hypothyroidism, sir. Hypothyroidism. So, I will
No, it may not be hypothyroidism. The point here is that the thyroid is not functioning even though there is a TSH. So, all thyroid goiters, whatever it is, are TSH dependent. That is the basic principle. Do you understand? So, how will you suppress the TSH? That is the answer.
Yes.
What is the answer? How will you suppress?
By giving thyroxine, sir.
Yes, very simple. That is the answer, actually. Do you understand? Don't worry, it happens. That is a routine thing. So,
how the nodule forms, same thing you have to apply here.
Yes.
Here is a replacement therapy. You have to replace the thyroid hormone so that thyroid will stop functioning. And that is most important to reduce the size.
Yeah. Sir,
Kishore, examiners would like to ask you, and these are the different questions to know that whether you know only about thyroglossal cyst or rest of the things. What the important point also to remember is, just like a puberty during puberty that thyroid enlarges, all this ectopic will enlarge during that time only. You understand? No, that should be the answer. See, if this patient were to have an ectopic thyroid, whatever we are talking, it should have enlarged not now. He is 40, what is that, 45 or something.
Mm.
So if you think it's a physiological one, but obviously malignant transformation can happen any age group. So if a child will come with a slow tongue enlargement there, posterior one-third at puberty level or so, that means it's a lingual thyroid. Sure. Just like you get in the neck, it also enlarges during that time. That is where the suppression will come. That is what we are discussing. So you need to keep it in mind, all these things. Yes.
Yes. So normally the first management is almost always suppression and conservative management. Then let the examiner ask you, what are the indication of surgery in ectopic thyroid? There are certain indications. Once patient passes the certain age, cosmetic becomes one with lifetime replacement, because we do total thyroidectomy. But as far as possible in a younger patient, it should be avoided. In a lingual thyroid, if suppression therapy doesn't work and patient has a difficulty in swallowing, recurrent bleeding is there, discomfort is there, respiratory sounds are there, then yes, still can be operated, followed by definitive thyroxine replacement for a lifetime.
Okay, sure.
Yes, sir.
What operation is performed for such patients?
Cystoid operations.
Okay, can you tell us a little more about that operation?
It means removal of the thyroglossal cyst along with the tract with removal of center part of hypoid. If removed, tract is removed up to that of 4 mm cecum.
Okay, what is the incision that you employ?
Transverse incision over the swelling.
Have you seen any one operation on
yes, sir.
This?
Yes, sir.
It's called as a step ladder incision. Okay, and what do you do when you reach the hyoid bone?
You have to remove the center part of the hyoid bone, sir. 1 centimeter clearance should be given.
Why?
Yes, because there's on a descending during development, the swelling may the thyroglossal tract may pass the hyoid bone in front as well as it can also descend downwards. It may pass behind the hyoid bone also, sir. So we might
may,
not.
May it, or always?
Always.
Always. Always.
Okay.
Okay. Then what do you do once you have gone past the hyoid bone? You have divided. You have gone past. Then what do you do?
We have to cut the muscles attached to the hyoid bone. Genial muscles as well as hyoglossus muscles should be cut off. And then we have to proceed excise up to foramen secum.
Okay, then that is what I would like to know. You put a finger into the
foramen secum.
And you depress the foramen secum and then you excise the tract. And then you put in a stitch there.
You ask your anesthesia colleague to put a finger in the mouth.
Yes.
And make it more calm.
Okay.
There's only time we can demand our anesthesia colleagues to put their finger in the mouth.
Yes.
Okay. So in which layer of neck the thyroglossal cyst is? Do you understand my question? How will you reach the cyst when you are operating?
In the plane of the cyst.
Plane of dissection. Yes, sir, has said very properly. I was
deep
not very
muscle
clear.
Is
which
deep.
Muscle?
Sternohyoid.
So it is behind the strap muscle. That should be kept in mind. By role of development, so it is a deep. It should be kept in mind. Right? Where will you cut the strap muscle if you need to cut? Not in this case, but in some cases of thyroglossal cyst.
At the origin of sternum, suprasternum.
Upper end, lower end?
Lower end.
As high as possible.
It's a upper end, as high as possible, near the attachment of thyroid itself.
Okay.
Why?
What is the nerve supply of the ribbon muscles?
You heard the ansar cervicalis?
Yes, sir.
In thyroid, if the strap muscle, the huge thyroid strap muscles you want to cut, where do you cut the strap muscles?
Midline.
Yes. You separate them, don't cut it.
Don't cut it.
That is retraction of the strap muscles. If you want to cut the strap muscles to deliver the huge thyroid, where do you cut it? And why? You cut it at the upper one third because the ansa cervicalis comes from behind, comes from below. That is the reason you cut it at the upper one third. Okay, that is what Sir is asking. Where do you cut the ansa cervicalis?
As high as possible, if needed. Right? So, what is the base of this cyst? What is lying exactly behind the cyst? Which part of the neck will be there behind the cyst? Because you have to be very careful. It is usually lying on a thyrohyoid membrane. So you have to be very careful when you separate it from thyrohyoid membrane. Because if you are not careful, you will be able to see the... What will you see?
Inside of larynx.
No, you will see the tube of anesthetist.
Yes, sir.
So yes, it is very tough structure, delicate, but you should know the lay of the thyroglossal cyst. So suppose, is there any difference in management if patient is already operated previously? That is a very common presentation. You should know that thyroglossal cyst will not be there. Then it will be presenting as either sinus or fistula or recurrent cyst. These are the presentation. Is there any difference?
No.
You should keep this in mind. In a case of recurrent cyst, you may not be able to elicit the movement with protrusion of tongue. It becomes sometimes difficult. But the history itself is a diagnosis. In the upper part of the neck, if you find the recurrent surgery, recurrent scar and sinus or a cyst which has recurred, unless proved otherwise, most of the time it is a thyroglossal cyst or a fistula. You should keep that in mind.
Yes, sir. Sure, I have two questions.
Yes, sir.
If somebody has operated and there is a thyroglossal fistula in a child, suppose you examine the child when the child is 15 years old, what will be your finding? You understood my question. Child was operated when child was 4 years old. Now you are seeing 15 years old. What will be finding there? Come on. Inadequately removed. So thyroglossal fistula and there's one important finding. That is why I asked you this question. That's called a hood sign. Hood. Like a, you know, semilunar sign. That is because, you know, child grows. So the skin elongates. The opening is same place. So the some kind of a covering of that fold. That is one question to you. So complications are, one is thyroglossal fistula. Why does thyroglossal cyst gets infected?
The cyst wall contains some lymphoid tissues, sir. So
that is the reason. Don't say it is communicating with the oral cavity. I have heard this in many questions. So branchial cyst, thyroglossal cyst, including for that matter. So they're all rich in lymphatics. That's why they get infected. Any other complications?
Malignancies.
So papillary carcinoma. These are the usual, and of course, a child or a girl or whatever. So cosmetic reasons. This is how. So you need to know the three types of mobility. You need to know the three differential diagnoses. We have already discussed that with you. And when we are asked a differential diagnosis, always say transamination positive means 1, 2, 3. Transformation negative means 1, 2, 3, especially in your case. Complications, and then of course the treatment. This is what you need to know in the examination. Sir, that's all from my side, sir.
Okay, I think shall we now plan to bring to an end the proceedings today?
Yes, sir. Yes,
and
sir.
I think we can ask the candidate himself how he would like to rate his performance.
Sir, one doubt, sir. Is it possible to differentiate papillary carcinoma arising from thyroglossal cyst, or it is an occult primary secondary? So how to differentiate these two? This is for the examiner.
Sir, I don't think we can make a diagnosis of clinical diagnosis of a papillary carcinoma in a cyst. We probably will not be able to. Very honestly, I have not seen. So maybe when you do the ultrasound, if there's any suspicious, probably, I don't know. Sir. That's all I can say.
What I believe is that to have a malignancy in a thyroglossal cyst, yes, papillary is extremely rare. Uh-huh. So if you find papillary CA anywhere other than thyroid itself, it should be considered a metastasis unless proved otherwise.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Kishore, do you have any doubts or clarifications, Kishore?
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yes,
sir. If it is a case, thyroglossal cyst, if it turns into malignant, sir, will we do a total thyroidectomy for this patient?
The answer to that is yes, you will do that. You will remove all the tissues in the tract along with the thyroglossal cyst, the tract right up into the foramen cecum. Not only that, you will look for lymph nodes within the area lying between the two internal jugular veins. Now, I think that should be about almost a complete operation.
Yes, yes, sir. I agree. I absolutely agree.
So, where did any that
central leg dissection?
Central leg.
To a total thyroidectomy. Even the normal thyroid, you have to remove.
Yes, you must keep in mind that this papillary carcinoma has occurred not in a normal setting. It has occurred in an abnormal setting. And you must remember that otherwise also, when you have papillary carcinoma, in more than 25% to 40%, you will have multifocal disease as in the other lobes in other areas. So it is worthwhile and wiser to remove the thyroid alone.
only help you in the radiooptic scan study and also in your therapy, any ablation study you have to do. If you have a normal tissue, it will be difficult. So whatever it is that, go for a total
therapy. Yeah, we will.
Dr. Sunil sir, what is the role of conservative thyroidectomy? Because now for papillary CA, the newer THROT and the newer NCCN is telling if their risk factors are minimal, consider lobectomy, hemithyroidectomy or lobectomy. Is that,
yes,
are we inching towards conservation, sir? Because what is your take on it, sir?
Yeah, we must understand that when we talk about conservation here, we are talking of an important thing, that the size of the tumor is very small. It is just about a centimeter, or in the other situation of about 2 centimeters. So we are looking at tumors which are just about less than 2 centimeters, only on one side in patients whom we would otherwise consider as low risk patients. There is no evidence to suggest metastasis. And all these patients will remain on a lifelong follow-up with us. So all these things considered, that we will be able to offer them a hemithyroidectomy. Hemithyroidectomy means a lobectomy along with the annexation of the pyramidal lobe going on, isthmus and the pyramidal lobe going on to the contralateral side. So this seems like a fair operation. And it is now being favored because let us face it, that in spite of the fact that we have very experienced surgeons who do lots of thyroidectomies year round, there is an incidence of nerve damage as well as damage to parathyroids. Number one. Number two, that in the long run, over 20 years also, you find that the long-term survival of all the patients with the hemithyroidectomy as well with the total thyroidectomy, it really doesn't work out to be much different. What works out to be different is the situation in which if there is a recurrence in the small subgroup, I think 7 to 11% may have a local recurrence in 15 to 20 years later, which is a little difficult.
Sir, how does the management of suppressive dose of thyroid go when we have a single, like hemithyroidectomy or a limited thyroidectomy?
No, in fact, sir, we do not do that. What we are doing is we are following up these patients on physical examination, on a neck ultrasound. And that is all. We are not subjecting them to thyroid scans at all, because we have left behind a functioning lobe on the other side. So that we know for a fact that it would not work in them. And there anyway, thyroglobulin is not going to be a marker in them, because as long as the other lobe is present there, we will not have the utility of thyroglobulin. So it boils down to a young patient having hemithyroidectomy for a very small tumor who is ready to be followed up for a very long time. These are the patients that you would like to have in your follow-up.
Yes, sir. I have got a discussion. The point is that many a time the problem, this condition, we have to think that we have already done the hemithyroidectomy on FNAC and the USCB, which is a TIRA-2-3 or a Bethesda-2-3 like that. And the post-operative, there is a surprise of papillary CA. Till now, it has been advised that you should go back and do a completion thyroidectomy. So are we again going toward that? We will just keep it like yes, that. And
I fully agree with you. And when we are faced with that situation and we think that there is something suspicious on the other side, we definitely go in and we do. You may call it as a new nomenclature called completion thyroidectomy. Over the last 20 years, we have coined this term. It's called completion thyroidectomy. We do that. Subsequently, yes, these patients will go up for a thyroid scan and they will go up for thyroid ablation. And these are the patients in whom we actually do thyroglobulin as a marker in these patients. And yes, I would say that in our own practice, we have about 15% of patients who behave in this particular manner.
Yes,
sir.
I have one small question, sir. Hey, we came across such question, such cases, where we did hemithyroidectomy and postoperatively turned out to be papillary carcinoma thyroid, because we are in a low risk zone and patient is in a low risk according to ages and AM scoring. So we didn't do a completion thyroidectomy, maybe 5-6 years back. And the patient is kept on suppressive dose of thyroxine. And now, after 5-6 years, they are coming back with enlargement of the other lobe of thyroid. That is what is my experience.
Okay, then can I humbly suggest to you, sir, that you have the other lobe also examined closely, get an fine needle aspiration done, get an ultrasound done, have a close look at it, and this is a very auspicious time. Take this opportunity and remove it also, so that the patient can be removed from follow-up as well.
So if the patient is lost for follow-up, that is the main problem.
Yeah, that is. So
that is he comes back with a lymph nodal metastasis.
Yes, in fact, whenever they are lost and they turn back, they always have regional recurrence. And
Indian scenario, better to remove it, sir.
Yes, I
fully
agree.
Yes. There are, as far as thyroid and papillary carcinoma, there are so many incidences are there, sir, that decision making, patient in don't surgery, we are also sometimes stuck. Plus, the pathology is pretty bad, like tall cell or capsular invasion, size, age, male patient, obviously. Male means, I think.
Male patient, of course. Male patient, we should always go for a total.
So no doubt. That is, I think, definitely we have to go. Otherwise, I think we can always observe. As sir, as Sunil sir has put it, high volume center, see, whatever we talk here, nerve injury, parathyroid. In fact, parathyroid is more troublesome, actually.
More troublesome, yes.
Really troublesome. Managing this calcium is much, much more difficult, actually. So that's what is. I also observed that in addition to this.
Quick question, Sunil sir. We have been always taught that post-operative remnant disease have to be treated with radioiodine ablation. For PAPCA, yes, it works very well, because at least in our department, we have a reasonable experience in PAPCA. But our nuclear physician always believes even in non-PAPCA, RA ablation is mandatory if there is a remnant disease. What is your experience, or how does it work with non-papillary CA remnants after surgery, sir?
Functional
residue, rather.
Yeah, let me first answer that for medullary carcinoma. It really doesn't work for medullary carcinoma because these are non-follicular cells, so they don't pick up radioiodine at all. So one set of cancers is out. Now the other set is anaplastic cancers. They hardly ever respond to any kind of treatment. So another set is also out. Now you have follicular carcinomas. Now follicular carcinomas are lesser in incidence. Probably in South India, they are a little more commoner in the north because we have the belt of multinodular goiter. That's a situation which is predisposed to development of follicular cancers also. So these are the patients in whom they would respond very well to radioiodine and ablation, and subsequently they'll be followed up serially. And you can get a thyroid scan as well as a whole body scan in these patients. And of course, the papillary carcinoma is very well followed up in these patients. But the other cancers are not good situations to carry out ablation as well as a scan.
And one last question, sir. We have been always taught FNA is not very great in follicular CA. So many limitations of FNA CA have now moved to FNA B as such. What is your take on, is there a challenge if you do a frozen section after hemithyroidectomy in differentiating between papillary and follicular CA? Sir, a couple of times we have had definite challenges. Pathologists on table reporting as PAP CA, and when we get the final biopsy report, it turns out to be follicular CA. It becomes little challenging to read those type of reports. Is there a definite difficulty for the pathologist for doing a frozen reporting? Sir,
I agree with you. It is very difficult for the pathologist to give us an answer, especially in thyroid. You see, thyroid is an endocrine gland. The function of the cells keeps changing, and the formation of the cells, everything keeps changing hour to hour, day to day, week to week. So it's very difficult for the pathologist to give you a particular diagnosis just based on about 10 to 20 cells. So that is their difficulty. Now, the other difficulty is for the surgeons. To organize a frozen section is not an easy thing. Number one, you do a hemithyroidectomy, let us say. Now, you take that hemithyroidectomy specimen to the pathologist, and you find that the pathologist is not good enough or not trained enough to interpret the thyroid frozen sections. Now, this is another challenge which you would actually encounter if you start doing the frozen section. So in All India Institute, we did dabble in frozen sections at one time, and then we burnt our fingers, and then we left it. So now what we do is, whatever is the status of FNAC, we follow the FNAC, and we do a hemithyroidectomy. If there is anything to suggest that we need to do more, we go in and we do a completion thyroidectomy. And we try to do all the things within the 2-3 weeks. Now, generally, it takes about 3 weeks' time, and we would have accomplished it also.
Yes, sir. I absolutely agree. We also follow. We have a high volume center with us and with HCG both. So we had in between tried with Kaustu, with a good friend of mine. We are of same batchmate. So we had a lot of discussion every time we come across this. And what they say, the ultimately, if you do FNA, hemi, and later on completion, frozen gives approximately same as FNA. It has not proven to be superior to FNA. That's why the frozen is not been accepted as a regular line. In a rare cases, when you are suspecting other kind of malignancy and you want to take a decision in rare cases, yes. Otherwise, FNAC is equal to frozen as far as the thyroid part is, follicular or papillary is concerned. It doesn't improve your take that it will give you on table papillary or follicle. That's what we understand, sir.
In between some recent advances earlier gave that frozen section, then they gave it up. And the explanation, even all that we have talked now, the word is over-treating. It actually, it amounts to over-treating, but it has to be accepted. That is what is now told, rather than redoing the case. Frozen section negative, final pathology is positive. Instead of trying to go in again,
same.
Over-treating. That's
what. Another thing is that frozen section is not easy to organize. You need a pathologist set up running all the time. You have to have a trained pathologist for the frozen section also. And remember that the patient is under anesthesia for that particular long duration.
Logistics also, 20-30 minutes is gone.
And about 35 to 50% of the time, the pathologist is not able to tell. They will tell you, sorry.
That's the main problem.
Okay.
One more thing is, we had something called imprint cytology. Do you have any experience about that?
Sir, it had come in and we had done a small thesis for one of the students. Effectively, imprint cytology means that you are performing the hemithyroidectomy. You are cutting the whole lobe as such, dividing it. And then you're taking a slide of the smear from that and then taking it to the cytologist. It is like doing the whole frozen section all over again. And the only more difficult part is now you need the cytologist as well to be trained in, giving you a diagnosis on the basis of this. Then again, they would fall short and would advise us to wait for the final. So we have not used it in the clinical practice, except for that one period when we did a thesis for someone.
Sir, I have one other sort of a more common scenario now we are getting. Because now we have made G-junction tumors and advanced cancer victims in our department all to go to protocol of neoadjuvant therapies. What really happens, sir, now we have a subsidized PET-CT for these study reasons. So PET-CT as a protocol three times is done in on the course of the duration of chemotherapy for study purposes. What happens is, sir, especially in G-junction adenocarcinomas, or for the study group, at least if you could see, if you are doing 10 patients, there is one or two cases coming up with the lighting nodule in the thyroid.
Yes.
What is that needs to be done, sir? Because we are totally in a different track of intensive chemotherapy or intensive chemo radiation for a GA cancer. With this focal uptake, many times radiologists is hesitant, sir, am I to put a needle or not? Because oncologist is very particular, don't violate any planes. If you are planning for something, please inform us, because they have their own limited assessments for that. But of course, we never had a challenge with thyroid so far. Do these ACV high uptake thyroids need something to be done at all, sir, when we are dealing with other cancers?
See, we face this problem, and what we have done is that when the patient comes up for operation, many of these patients will come up for operation.
Correct.
So at that time, we just go and do the hemithyroidectomy on the site which they are doing the resections, so that it becomes easier for them to do the gastric pull-up and then anastomosis and all. Now, the other patients in whom we are not going to be doing any such procedure,
correct,
we just keep them on follow-up while the chemotherapy, radiotherapy is being carried out. And it is only once they have accomplished that and everything is settled down, then we take a look at that. We should not forget, at least in North India, we should not forget that the incidence of thyroid disease, which is non-malignant, is also extremely high. Remember that about 15 to 20% of our patients have actually got thyroiditis. And more than that is the percentage of people who would have got what is related to adenomatous or iodine deficiency goiters. So we have a very high incidence of this particular disease. So we are not so bent upon investigating all the thyroid. We would like to add to the treatment of the patient.
I think primary disease needs to be tackled, Dr. Kanakavelu, whatever you are.
Sir, we still do the primary, sir.
I know. What I'm trying to tell is incidentalomas are actually quite known.
Yes.
So yes. I think a small nodule less than that cystic, I think, should be observed rather than probably.
Absolutely.
I don't know.
The advantage of esophagectomy is, as sir said, you are exposing the neck, you have access to the thyroid, sir. But if you're doing something in the colorectal and other zones, or sir, I find difficult to the young generation postgraduate residents who ask us questions. Sir, normally when you see a high ACV uptake, you evaluate so much and you're not doing anything for thyroid. Truly, I could not answer them. So I just wanted to see from a high volume department what is their approach, sir. I'm fine with waiting and watching and treating the primary cancer. No second thought about it, sir. But I felt I should ask the expert to get an answer from his department, sir.
Let's wait whenever possible, but let's operate whenever the operation is being done.
Best of both worlds.
I think this is becoming a thyroid conference as such.
Rather than
the permission of the faculty, I thank all the invited faculty for the day. Professor Sunil sir, Professor Srihari sir, Professor Neena ma'am, and all the our own regular faculty. Thank you, Kishore, and thank you, Priyanka. Thank you for joining us. We look forward for yet another important class for the coming Friday.
Thank you.